Yeah, for sure. I mean, I came there when I was a kid, when I was 4 or 5 years old, back in the 60s, saw my first Grand Prix, standing at Cox Bank, all the way through to touring cars, Formula 3, Formula 1. Then I got on the board, then I became chairman of the board, and we put all the car parks and dual carriageways and all that together. So, and now obviously with TV, so I'm 54 years old, and 50 of those is involved around Silverstone. So yeah, I feel huge. I think pride, satisfaction, excitement whenever I drive in and drive over the bridge.
Obviously, you travel around the world now going to all the circuits. Is Silverstone up there with the best? Is it able to hang on for the future, do you think?
Well, I hope so. I think every year is a peril because, you know, it's hard for them to keep finding the money. They're not sponsored by a government like most of the places that we go to. So it's purely on a commercial basis. And as we see, all the European Grand Prix are struggling. Even if they are supported by regional or national governments. So I think it's an ongoing struggle. So hopefully we'll win here. Got a long-term contract. I think what's unique about Silverstone is it's got the history and heritage, but it's got fantastic facilities as well. You know, if I go to Sao Paulo or Montreal or Monza, they just don't have these kind of facilities. So I think, you know, and you have to have some of that history and that spirit. Otherwise, you know, all the modern circuits are fine. And some of them, you know, some of the events like Singapore, for example, work very well. But there'll be half a century, if ever, getting the history of this place because so many things have happened, and not just in Formula One. So I think this place is pretty unique in that respect. And obviously, it's been on, you know, the British Grand Prix has been on the cards ever since day one. So we have to fight to keep it.
Do you think realistically, Formula One, just from that heritage point of view, it wouldn't be the same? Could it survive without Britain?
Well, there's a lot of teams based here, of course. I think it's 8 of the current 11 are here in the UK. And the cottage industry of motorsport, and it's a huge business. And we'd be, you know, we to an extent, we gave up our building cars and we gave up making motorcycles. We can't afford to give up our motorsport industry. So, and Silverstone's pivotal to that. You know, it is pretty much the centre of gravity of British motorsport. So you've got the university going up over there, you've got facilities still developing. I know it's hard work, and it will always be a struggle here because it's run by a club, owned and run by a members club, private members club. So, but you know, nobody wants to see it fade away, and I don't think it will.
And you were talking about the tradition of it. I mean, do the modern drivers feel that when they come here? I mean, obviously, maybe the Brits more so, but do you think there is that sense, or are people less aware of it?
Now, because the national racing in Great Britain is so strong, most drivers have come through British championships somewhere along the line, particularly Formula 3, of course. So they know Silverstone well. A lot of them have lived here as well. You know, when they come from Brazil or whatever, their first their first port of call used to be Van Diemen in Norfolk, or you know, Barrichello. Yeah, moving from Sao Paulo to Cambridge and that sort of thing. So I think they have an affinity as well to Great Britain and the British motorsport scene. I think what they love about it are the high-speed corners, frankly. That's what, you know, so they come and they enjoy Silverstone. I think if it was a Mickey Mouse track, they'd be nice at the end of it. They love challenging themselves against high-speed corners that are not quite flat out, like Cox and Beckett and Stowe and places like that. So that's why they come and rave about it.
If somebody had to put a gun to your head and say, which was your favourite Grand Prix of all the British Grand Prix you've ever seen or participated in, which one would you choose?
For me personally, it was 92 when I finished on the podium. The track was invaded by the crowd at the end, which was naughty, but really good to see. And they mustn't do that anymore, but otherwise we'll get fined or something. The one I really enjoyed, I mean, obviously when I came and saw them as a kid, there were some great races here. I think probably the most dramatic that I've commentated on would be the 2008 race of the car I'm going to drive today, when Lewis won in the rain, where I thought he was just extraordinary that day. I don't know how he found the grip. I don't know, he just had a confidence and a skill that day that was beyond, way beyond anybody else out there. So that one sticks in my mind. Crazy Priest running down the track. Rubens won it there. It was quite an exciting race, wasn't it? I can't remember what year it was.
2003, wasn't it?
Yeah. So there's been some classics. Mm. There's been some really great races, and it's a tough track. That's why.
Yeah. I mean, in 92, as you say, you made the podium. What's it take to win at Silverstone? Because I know we talk about it was a very fast track, and I guess even with the changes, it still is a very fast track.
Always.
What is it? Is it
track to keep their character by and large. I mean, I won a lot of races in Formula 3 and World Sports Car Championship with Jaguar, and that. You need a car that you can believe in and trust, because you are carrying huge beats through corners. You know, whatever the layout, it's always had a flavour of speed, a theatre of speed, if you like. So, and that's good. I mean, I think it will. And you know, you've got the infield here, which is quite unusual at a lot of racetracks, and there's so many aspects of it that are different.
What's your thought on the current layout? Is it something that you see roasting at the spectacles with the old layout?
I raced it last year in the Sports Car Championship with my son, actually, and I really enjoyed it in the LMP2 car. Turn one's cracker, an absolute cracker. And yeah, do what you like, mate. I just need to check what I was doing on my helmet radio there. The question again?
Just your thoughts on the current layout.
I don't mind it. I think what's clever about it is they can have different events here, and they can segment here and maximise, sweat the asset, which you've got to do. That's the only way Silverstone can survive, is completely sweat the asset. I go to a lot of tracks that are this size around the world, and they've got all sorts of ambitions about young drivers and about race schools, and never ever happens, and the places don't get used from one year to the other. It's tragic, really. This place is flat out every day because it has to be to survive, and it's nice to see. So I don't mind the new layout. I think it's good in a fast car. I think some of the slower cars, it takes them a bit too long to get round, if I'm honest. The lap's a bit too long. What's a Formula 3 car running? Just over 2 minutes. Yeah. So a lot of cars will be 2.5 minutes. So it's probably, but they don't always race on that layout. I think in an F1 car, just over a minute and a half. Spot on.
Yeah. As far as British drivers for this year go, who do you think stands a chance of getting on the podium? Lewis, I suppose.
Lewis has got a chance, hasn't he? Paul Di Resta. You fear for Jensen a little bit, because his car, if they don't find improvements in the car, I'm afraid this place will show up a deficient car. They should be better here, hopefully, but it's more, you know, they've been hurting on the bumpy tracks and the low speed traction zones, so they should be alright. Paul Di Resta's got half a chance. Lewis is the main chance, I thought, for the British fans. But I really think the British fans, and they always have and they always will, support. They appreciate something special, whether it's a Brazilian or a German or whatever. They're motorsport fans first and foremost, rather than just beating the drum and waving the union flag.
What would you say to those that haven't brought a ticket yet to come to the event?
I mean, obviously, I love making Formula 1 television, but there's nothing beats seeing and hearing and feeling them live. You know, come in. It's if you haven't ever seen a Formula 1 car in anger, in action, it's on your bucket list. You need to be here and you need to see it.
Before, it's a special occasion for drivers. It must be. Is it a special occasion for you to be driving this, the Hamilton's car? I mean, yeah. I know in a McLaren, I guess.
Yeah. Every time I get in a Formula 1 car, I was here 2 weeks ago in a Red Bull for a day, and it was raining sideways, but we still got some really good stuff out of it. Did 30 odd laps in that RB7. Every time I drive a modern F1 car, I assume it's my last time ever in a modern F1 car, so I really enjoy it. It's a big thing for me.
Any problem is it's a bit ugly, isn't it?
It is compared to Senna's car, isn't it? Yeah, all the bits hanging off it. Yeah, what you have to do with that car, I saw it on a plinth at the racing car show, or whatever they call it now at Birmingham. And it was up on a plinth, and you look at it and you realise what it is. It's a racing car within a tube. The whole thing is one big tube that runs from the front to the back of it to channel the air, so they band all those bits. If you get down and have a look down the nose of it, and you'll see what I mean.
The impressive bit of engineering is just all the chimneys and wings and stuff.
Yeah, and one little bit of contact, and they lose, X amount of downforce, and pulled back through the field. But you know, that car of Senna's, it's got wide tyres, wide suspension, there's a purity to it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Jolly good show.
Right, let me see what we're doing.